Good evening to everyone. Thanks for giving me this opportunity to come and speak to all of you. My key area of interest is stroke. I finished my MBBS in Annamalai, come to India from 2015. Initially, I set up a stroke service at Apollo Main Hospital. And now I've moved to Kaveri from October 2017, where we have set up a hyperacute stroke unit. I don't know how many of the doctors here treat acute stroke, like IV thrombolysis, thrombectomy, and so on. Could you please show your hands? Thank you. IV stroke treatment has progressed very rapidly since 2000, after the IV thrombolysis trials came out of US. 1995 was the first positive trial. But the actual treatment started picking up only in the in 2000 onwards. But still, in India, I think in urban centers, in a few places, we do hyperacute stroke thrombolysis, but we still have a lot of catching up to do. Now we have moved further ahead of IV thrombolysis to intra-arterial thrombectomy, where we can do exactly what the cardiologists do to take the clot out. And we have treated quite a few patients successfully in Chennai, both at Apollo and Kaveri, where they have walked home within a week of having a very major disabling stroke. So I'll start with a case where we treated a gentleman who's only 46 years, who came to us on the 20th of November. He was working in an IT company nearby in Les Corner. So they rushed him. So he was having lunch with his mates, and he collapsed suddenly with inability to talk and unable to move his right side. And it was at 1:20. And luckily, he worked very close to us, he came to us within 30 minutes of onset. And he was taken to the CT room within the next 15 minutes. Hyperacute stroke unit sort of comprises a lot of things we do at a very fast pace. So we aim to do the CT scan within 20 minutes of arrival. There's no time wasted in ER doing tendon examination or looking at plantars or anything. If a person looks like having a stroke, they should go to the CT. We should not waste any more time. So he had a CT which looked like this. So hyperacute CTs will be absolutely normal. So many often I have seen patients who had a normal CT and they were doubtful and they sent across for MRI and they wasted time and the golden hour has gone. So hyperacute CT will be normal even up to 12 hours after onset of stroke. And you only start seeing changes sometimes even 24 hours later. So this CT is usually, we do the hyperacute CT mainly to rule out a bleed. If there's no bleed, then you're fine to start thrombolysis unless they don't have any contraindications. The usual contraindications will be if they had a previous hemorrhagic stroke or previous hemorrhage due to any other bleeding diathesis or other complications or subarachnoid hemorrhage in the past and so on. Very limited contraindications. If none of these are there, just very quick questions to the relatives, then you should go ahead and give it. And 10% of strokes will be stroke mimics, like it could be a migraine with hemiplegic parases, or it could be a focal seizure, dots parases, it could be anything. But you don't have to worry, even if you thrombolyze those patients, they're not going to end up with complications. So, with the hyperacute protocol, we also do a CT angiogram from the arch of aorta all the way to the vertex, because we need to know where the clot is. If the clot is, for example, in the carotids or in the middle cerebral artery, the chance of recanalization with IV thrombolysis is only about 50% if it is in the MCA and 20% if it is in the carotid arteries. So you can't really help much just with IV thrombolysis. These patients will need a thrombectomy. So, you can see this is the right internal carotid artery and left internal carotid artery. So you can see there's a filling defect sitting there. There's a thrombus. And it's in the sagittal view, you can see it's a very long filling defect. And there's no flow beyond in the carotid. And normally when you have such a long filling defect, you wonder whether there's a dissection. In a young person like this gentleman, with no actual known risk factors, dissection is often the presenting complication that gave a stroke. So I'll tell the story of how we had it later. So he was immediately taken after the IV thrombolysis. We aimed to do the IV bolus one CT table, even before the CT, they leave the CT room. So it just tells the urgency with which we have to treat stroke patients, because each and every passing minute you lose a lot of neurons. So I can play the video. This is the in the cath lab. We can see. So the common curves.
Previous slide. You can see the filling defect here.
That's where the ICA should be, and there is a long plot. We saw the previous shot where you saw the lateral view, the common carotid itself, you can see the clot, but up there in the ICA there's a clot sitting there, and there's another clot in the MCA. Normally you would see the MCA filling up nicely, but because of a clot blocking it, you can't see the branches that should be coming up this side. So this gentleman, this is after we have started the IV thrombolysis. Almost 80% of the infusion is gone, and he is in the cath lab, because it takes some time to get into the cath lab, do the groin puncture, prepare everything, get the wire all the way up to the arch, and go into the common carotid. So this is a shot where you can see the stent placed, stent wire placed within the system. Click one. So this is the distal end of the stent, and this is where the clot is. So what we do is, you can see that when the retriever is released, the stent expands, and we hope the clot will get embedded within the stent. And then we pull the whole wire in total, and it comes with the clot. Next slide, please. Next slide. So you can see it's being pulled down. We can't really visualize the clot, but when we leave the stent there for 5 minutes and wait for the clot to end it. And then when you take the stent out, the assumption is the clot comes with it. And then you do another diagnostic run with contrast to see if you have recanalized fully. And if you haven't, you can go and do one more attempt. Click for it, please. So with the diagnosis, we can see previously there was no flow beyond that. Now we can see a lot of flow coming up to all the MCA branches. The MCA main stem is clearly visualized. And this gentleman started talking on the CT, on the cath lab table, and he started moving his arms and legs on the CT table itself. As he was wheeled out, he was able to talk to his wife. As he was wheeled in, he couldn't talk. It was a huge moment of celebration for everybody, for us and also for the family. And he was taken to the ward, and this is normally when we do a procedure like IV thrombolysis or any procedure, we have to do a repeat scan next day to look for any bleeding complications, so you can plan when you can start aspirin and other secondary prevention methods. This is the scan, the MRI we did next day. It's a very small impact in the endiform nucleus, which is not going to cause any neurological deficit at all. You can imagine if the clot was still left in, he would have been heavily paralyzed for the rest of his life, and he was the main breadwinner for the family with two kids who are attending school. And he went home on day 4, and he came back to see us on day 7. And we did a lot of workup to see why he had it, and on Doppler views, after day 7, we could see there was a dissection flap. So he was kept on antiplatelets and clexane for a month's period of time. And when we repeated the Doppler, the flap is completely healed and there is no more clot. And the 2 weeks scan, there was a small clot sitting in the common carotid, which slowly dissolved over a period of months of IV, so not IV, subcut, low molecular weight heparin. So it's a success story, and we have at least 4 patients who had done extremely well with this sort of treatment in COVID in the last 6 months. In IV thrombolysis, we do quite a lot. In the last 1 week, we have done for 2 patients who have made a very good recovery. So just to recap our stroke, what happens immediately after stroke, you can see there is a core immediately after the stroke onset, there's a bit of penumbra where it's partially perfused, which is what we try to salvage with IV or IA treatments. And usually, if no treatment is given, the core expands and the whole area is damaged, and it leaves with dense weakness. So this is a very beautiful slide where this gentleman, Jeffrey Elsay, which is, he is a very well-known person from America, who's a pioneer in stroke medicine. So he just sort of came up with a sort of a number behind time and the amount of neurons lost per second with a very large artery stroke. 32,000 neurons are lost, and 230 million synapses are lost as soon as the stroke starts. And we start age by at least 8 hours. And per minute, you can see the amount of neurons that are lost with each passing minute. And by the end of a stroke, nearly 1.2 billion neurons are lost, and a person would have aged by at least 36 years. We all see stroke patients who are with very large volume strokes, who are bedridden, can't do much, and often they die prematurely because of bed sores or aspiration pneumonias and various other complications. So what we can really do is we can arrest the progression into a very disabling stroke or even prevent death by doing all these sort of interventions. So we treated a gentleman who had a basilar artery thrombosis, and he developed symptoms when he was in Chidambaram. He lived there, and he somehow heard about us, and his family drove him in the middle of the night, and they reached Calvary at 6 in the morning, and he had his thrombectomy just before 9 a.m., and he survived. Basilar artery thrombosis, as we all know, is a 90, almost 100% mortality. And he's back to his normal self, he's doing his business and everything. So this is a slide just to show what happens. Early scan may appear normal, but in this scan you can see a little bit of edema compared to the other side. This is what we often see in the early scan. So here the sylvian fissure is nicely seen. In the early stages, because of cytotoxic edema, there is a slight increase in swelling. You can see the sulci and gyri nicely, but here it's all effaced. And as time goes on, you can see the whole infarct getting hyperdense. That is how stroke progresses. So, as I said, 1995 was the first study which came up with a positive result with IV thrombolysis. Since then, the outlook on stroke has changed. We may all remember when I was in Annamalai University, stroke patient, Mandali, they'll be left in a corner with a drip and nobody cares, and there's nothing much you can do. We would just discharge them home with sort of pathic and they don't know what. But now everything has changed. So this is, these are the trials that came out last year from March onwards, from 2015 onwards, which showed that thrombectomy has been done for quite a while, from 1990, then 2000 onwards, but the initial trials were all negative. So there was not much enthusiasm to take this on board, but now the devices have become more refined. The complication rates with those devices are very little, and the ease of operation is also very good. So anybody who has done a year of fellowship in interventional radiology can do it. They won't be able to do very complex aneurysm, flow diverters and so on, but stroke thrombectomy is very simple. So if anybody can easily learn it and do it. So we need to more and more doctors to go and have this done, because as you all know, stroke incidence is increasing very rapidly in India, with aging population, increased lifestyle risk factors and so on. I'll quickly skip all these slides because we are all has led us to go on to the current new treatment. This slide is a bit important because we all know that golden hour for IV thrombolysis is up to 4.5 hours. Beyond that, the risk of bleeding increases with IV thrombolysis, so the tendency is to offer thrombectomy if somebody comes in after 4.5 hours, within 4.5 hours if they have a large volume clot, or after 4.5 hours even in basilar artery thrombosis, we can go up to 12 hours. But in this trial, we have found that the penumbra is there in very few selected patients, even up to 24 hours, especially if they have very good collections. So the current
idea of
4.5 hour window is only for centers which cannot do early CT angiograms. If you're able to do a CT angiogram and if you can demonstrate collaterals, it can thrombolyze even up to 12 hours. And in posterior circulation, you can even up to go up to 24 hours. So there are a lot of young people who may have basilar artery thrombosis who you can really treat them and see if you can bring them back. This is a very good slide. So you can see there's occlusion here because of a clot, but you can see a lot of flow even in the cortical branches here, probably through the circle of Willis from ACA and PCA, sort of rerouting of blood. But here, similar patient with a clot, with very comparative to the top row, you can see a little bit of reduction in the collateral flow. So the outcome with this patient, in this patient, will be lesser compared to this person, because this person would have a core with a very good penumbra. Obviously, with little collaterals, the penumbra is going to be very smaller. And in this person, they've got a clot here, there's no flow, but there's no collateral at all. Even if you do thrombectomy or IV thrombolysis, they're not going to do well at all. So you can actually select your patients based on scientific evidence rather than a random number like 4.5 hours, if you can do a CT angio. So we all know stroke is classified into hemorrhagic and ischemic. And of the ischemic strokes, 50% are due to vessel occlusion like what we saw. In majority, it is due to a thrombus in the calcified plaque in the ventral carotid artery or MCA branch or lacunar strokes, or embolization from the heart from mitral valve problems or atrial fibrillation and so on. In a one-fourth of patients, we may not identify the reasons, especially in very young patients. In those patients, we have to keep looking for causes, including thrombophilia screen, antiphospholipid antibody screens, and some patients, if you may want to do some genetic testing also in a young person. You may want to screen for PFO to look for right to left shunts. I'll just quickly skip. So this slide, I got it from one of the drug companies, because unfortunately there is not much epidemiological data of stroke prevalence, and somehow they have found this from WHO link, and it's estimated there are about 15.4 lakh persons with stroke, and nearly half of them die every year because of stroke, and they do not survive. I mean, this can be easily rectified if we can implement hypercritical stroke pathways and treatment in all the major centers to start with, and then maybe trickle down to other district hospitals and decent sized hospital in the city. So there is no high technology involved. It's a CT scan, CT angio, and then you just do a thrombolysis to begin with. So there are a lot of risk factors we all know. I won't go on, we have very little time. Hypertension. I just want to stop here because just having hypertension alone is not a major stroke risk factor. There are a lot of patients who have variable hypertension. The blood pressure is quite variable. So if you do a 24-hour ambulatory BP monitoring, it should be like this. So at night time it dips, and then you start, in the early morning it starts to go up. that there are a lot of people who may have extremely variable blood pressure. This is on a person who has gone to their doctor's visit and then come down at home and preparing dinner, email, watching TV in bed and in sleep. There's a very little dip and then they're awake in bed, washing up, driving. You can see quite a lot of variability. These patients are the ones who are more risk of having stroke rather than somebody who's just having high BP. So having a normal BP or a 140 by 80 during our clinic visit doesn't mean everything is fine. It is very important to look for 24 ambulatory BP and see if the risk factor can be nicely controlled. Another tip is beta blockers increase BP variability. Calcium channel blockers actually dampen the variability. So you may want to choose calcium blockers over beta blockers for your patients with stroke risk. So those patients who have hypertension, diabetes, alcohol risk, and high smokers, they often end up having lacunar strokes, like small dots in the deeper areas of the brain where the perforators are located. They may have excessive small vessel disease, and so on. But these are all easily modified risk factors. So these are the ones, people who can we can really help to reduce future stroke burden. Atrial fibrillation, as we all know, as with increasing age, the incidence increases. Those who are above 70 have a 5 to 7% risk, and above 80, 10% risk. So anybody who is in this age bracket, please ask for palpitations and check if they have. The pickup rate with ECG, which is just for 10 seconds, is about 2.5%. You can easily miss somebody with paroxysmal AF. If you do a 24-hour Holter monitor, the pickup rate is up to about 5%. If you do a 5-week monitor, it is about 12%. So if you have somebody who has no other risk factors and they keep having stroke, you should please do a 5-day monitor at least to screen them thoroughly. Because strokes due to AF are the most deadliest strokes. They have a very large volume clot, they often block the MCA, and they end up having a very disabling stroke. If you have somebody with atrial fibrillation, you can use the chance to BASC score to choose who may be okay with antiplatelets, or you may want to do anticoagulation. There are a lot of patients who are on just an aspirin clopidogrel combination with AF. It is not going to serve purpose at all. The stroke risk reduction with aspirin clopidogrel combination or even single agent is only about 20%. They need to be on anticoagulation, either acitromycin or the newer agents. There are quite a lot of new agents in the market. Dabigatran has come off the patent. The cost has come from 150 per tablet to 20. It's now affordable, and you don't have to worry about monitoring compliance and so on. So I prefer using the newer anticoagulants, and currently I use more of dabigatran because it is cheaper for the patients. So you can give 110 BD or 150 BD, and there is no need for monitoring, no need for INR checking, and it gives a very steady state control. The risk of bleeding with newer agents is less, and the stroke protection is also higher. So it's almost with 70% stroke risk reduction. So putting them on antiplatelets and assuming they are protected is completely wrong. If they have AF, they should be on anticoagulants unless there is a very justifiable contraindication not to be on anticoagulation.
For how long?
Sorry?
Anticoagulation for how long?
Duration.
It will be lifelong. Yes. So the AF is not going to go away. The risk of cardioversion, changing them back to normal rhythm is impossible. In a young person with AF, yes, you may be able to do cardioagulation in various. In an older person, it's impossible. They have to be on lifelong anticoagulation. Sorry? So the other group of patients who will have stroke is those with carotid stenosis. Just want to stress, whenever we ask for a scan, the scan centers say MRA normal, and they only do the MRA from the from your intracranial portion. They don't do the neck MRA. The ICS stenosis usually happens at the origin, that is here, and you will be falsely reassured that the MRA is normal. You have to ask specifically in a stroke patient to screen them from arch of aorta all the way to the vertex. Unless you ask, they're not going to do that because it takes another 5 minutes on the table. It's loss of money for them. So you are not going to catch your patients. If they have aortic stenosis and the degree of stenosis is more than 70%, the risk of stroke in the next month is almost 40%. And just by doing a carotid endarterectomy, you can reduce the stroke risk drastically. If you haven't done that, if you haven't looked for the ICA, then you're going to miss a very preventable stroke. So if the patient is unfit for surgery, you can do carotid stenting. I'll just skip these slides. Aneurysm, so subarachnoid hemorrhage is one of the devastating forms of stroke. So ABCD to score will be very useful for us in community. If somebody comes to us with transient symptoms of facial numbness, weakness, or giddiness, transient arm which has recovered completely, you can use this score to risk stratify. If the score is 4 and above, they should be preferably admitted and worked up for stroke prevention. So if you have somebody with a score of 4 and above, you can see the 2-day to 30-day risk is it goes up gradually. If the score is 7, the 2-day risk is about 5%, and 3-month risk is almost more than 20%. And just by simply starting them on aspirin, statins, and BP medicines, or if they have any other risk factors, just modifying those factors will reduce their stroke pretty drastically. But the only key here is not to use antihypertensives in the first 24 hours. Everybody who has had a stroke or a TA will have a very high blood pressure. All of them will have 180, 190. And majority of the time I've seen patients having had acute antihypertensive medicines. And they end up having loss of penumbra. So the brain is auto-regulating. There is an area of blockage. It's sending signals to increase the flow. So that is why the blood pressure is up. And if you reduce it, fear of high BP, not other stroke, one there, then they're going to lose the penumbra. They're going to extend the stroke. The first 24 hours, do not lower the BP. And the other reason not to lower it, until you have seen the carotids, like if they have a very tight stenosis, like if they may have a 90% stenosis, and they are relying on the 10% trickle flow, and if the BP is normalized in these patients, they are going to have a devastating large volume stroke. So it's better to check the carotids before you initiate a proper BP management. So stroke unit care has progressed from individual care to some ward-based care to now we are going to comprehensive stroke unit where we do rehab with in-house physio, occupational therapy, speech therapy, and everyone. I'll just stop here because there's a lack of time. Thanks for the opportunities. Sorry, sir. Cost for the thrombectomy procedure.
For the first patient.
So he's interesting. He was riding his bike, and it was raining on that day. So he put on his sweater, and he was trying to put the zip very quickly, and he pulled it up, and the thumb, his finger slipped from the zipping, and it just hit his neck here, very hard. And on the same night, he had some sore throat and neck pain for next 2 days. It happened 3-4 days ago. And when he went to see his local doctor, he was examined in his neck and everywhere. They thought he may have had mild pharyngitis, and he was given augmentin. But he didn't get better. Simultaneously, he also had mild headache. And the fourth day, when he was in his office, so what happens is when you have dissecting slabs, there is a little bit of pain locally. And the flow limitations causes recruitment of collaterals from extra meningeal arteries that gives you headache. Most patients will experience headaches with dissection. And so he was sort of wondering what is happening. And as the time went on, the clot propagated more and more, and the flap kind of dissected more and more. And the clot went all over the place. And when it blocked the MCA, that's when he developed his symptoms.
Is there any with aspirin and proctor? Is there any drug to be given to prevent stroke?
It's just preventing the factors only. There is no, if you can identify patients who may have, so for example, you could screen the carotids, ECG for AF, if they have hypertension. Just controlling all the risk factors alone is what one can do.
When you do carotid doctor, sometimes they give age-related changes.
If it is less than 60% stenosis, there is no, and if it is asymptomatic, there is no intervention either. We only do intervention if it is more than 60-70%, and only on the symptomatic side. If it is asymptomatic, there is no intervention either, but they should be on high-dose statins, antiplatelets. Majority of the patients with basilar artery stroke will have experienced vertigo, giddiness in the first 2 weeks before they had a proper basilar artery stroke. So it is very important to ask specific questions to make sure they are not, so it's often very difficult to differentiate peripheral causes versus central causes. But if they have, yeah, in statins, I use 80 milligram Atorva or 40 Rosuva, because Rosuva statin is stronger. 20 Rosuva is similar to 80 Atorva, so either of the two I use. So simvastatin is out of favor because you can't combine with amlodipine when it gives rhabdomyolysis risk.
Now I request Dr. Dandapani, senior physician, to come forward and hand over the certificate appreciation to Dr. Sivarajan.